Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining this live event. In this episode we discuss the Singleton pattern, so it's our continuation of the design patterns stream. If you are watching the event live, don't forget that we have a live chat there, so you can ask me questions directly in the live chat. If you watch the event recorded, you can still ask me questions in the comment section, or you can follow me on Twitter and LinkedIn and we can discuss there as well. So today we continue with Singleton. Singleton is considered to be the simplest of the design patterns. However, in my experience, I know that many developers don't know all the details about Singleton, and trust me, besides that, Singleton can be implemented in many ways. It's basically so many ways here that it doesn't even make sense to discuss all of them, but in this episode I will discuss at least the most important ways to implement the Singleton. But before starting today, I see I have a question already in the chat, and someone asks me to draw the class diagrams for the decorator and adapter patterns, which are the design patterns we discussed in the previous episode. And yes, I remember that you asked me at the end of the last episode that as well, and I didn't have the time to do that. So because I always want to start with answering the questions, I would like to start with this class diagrams first. So clarify the adapter and the decorator, and then step into the Singleton pattern. So let's start with the adapter, which is very simple. Actually, both of them are very simple. You remember from the previous episode that they are quite similar one to the other. So in case you missed the previous episode in which I discussed decorator and adapter with examples, my recommendation is watch it, because it's quite relevant. These two design patterns, they are part of those that you will find quite often in implementations. In case of the, I said adapter first, so let's remember what adapter is. So it's basically a way, its purpose is to, as the name suggests, adapt an interface to another. So you have some kind of an object requiring to consume a specific interface, and you want to provide it with an implementation that doesn't comply with that specific interface. How do you do that? So this is the problem, and the design pattern is of course the solution. Let's just draw this rectangle and consider this is the object which we can call the consumer or client or whatever you want to name it. So this is the object that needs to use, again, a specific interface. So I will draw another rectangle representing that specific interface that we need to use. If you remember, now going back to the example I gave you in the previous episode, my example, my favorite example in the adapter case is the Spring Security user details. If you remember, said that one good example for the adapter, which is quite often encountered today, is adapting, for example, a way to represent the user to the user details interface in case of Spring Security. So in that case, if you want to make this example a little bit less ambiguous, you can say that this is basically the Spring Security implementation. So this is basically Spring Security that behind the scenes needs to, even smaller than this. Yeah, so behind the scenes needs to adapt whatever implementation to that user details implementation. So remember, in Spring Security, the user is represented by the user details interface. So whatever you implement in your application, if you want Spring Security to understand that as your user, you need to make sure that it complies with the user details contract. So I say here user details. In the previous episode I even made a short implementation for that. So how do you basically adapt your, in my previous episode was the example with the JPA entity. So I have that JPA entity that maps a table in the database and is not, does not precisely comply with the contract that Spring Security expects. So how do you do, how do you make such in a way in which your class representing the user entity that maps the table in the database also complies with this interface without, of course, making it implement the interface? So you have this class user, and this class user, just imagine, is just your JPA entity. It doesn't implement the interface you need, and you need to somehow make Spring Security understand it. So this is the user entity, and this is also called, so if I want to use the terminology, this is the adaptee. That means the object you want to adapt. So how do you adapt the adaptee to the contract? Okay, so let me make this the adaptee. Okay, and I will move the adaptee somewhere near the interface just to make sure that you understand the adaptee doesn't implement the interface. And basically that's the problem. So the problem is that you'd have liked the adaptee to implement the interface, but it doesn't, isn't it? So how do you solve that? And basically that's quite easy to solve it. So what you actually do is you implement your object that implements the interface, and that is what we will call the adapter. So the adapter is the object that's adapting the adaptee to the interface. And in our previous example, I don't remember precisely, but I think I named that security user or something like that. So this is the adapter. Adapter. And I think the name again in my previous example in the last episode was security user. So what does the adapter do is it's extending the interface. So it's extending the interface and contains the adaptee, such that the adapter wraps over the adaptee and adapts its methods to the interface. So basically this is what this is, the class diagram to what we discussed in the, to one of the patterns that we discussed in the previous episode. So the adapter, so this way the adapter contains the adaptee, adapting it to the interface that's needed in the end by the object using it, which is also named the client. So in our example, Spring Security needs a user details, but our adaptee is not implementing the user details interface. So the adapter wraps over the adaptee, implements the interface so that it makes it gives the adaptee a shape in which Spring Security understands it. So that's basically everything. And that's exactly what we implemented in our example last week in our previous episode. And also in the previous episode, we discussed the decorator. And remember that the decorator pattern is very similar with the adapter. The similarity mainly comes from the fact that both patterns rely on wrapping over an object. So basically we can say that the adapter also decorates the adaptee, the difference being that the reason why the adapter does that is different. So in case of the adapter, the reason why it wraps over the adaptee is to adapt it to a specific interface so that some other object can use it, while in case of the decorator, the main purpose is to enhance the functionality. And you remember that in case of the decorator, you can also decorate the decorate multiple times the object, so you can add theoretically from the design patterns perspective an infinite number of layers one above the other. And the advantage is that this is very flexible, because you can have as many layers as you want and in what order you want them. And if you go back, I won't just re-explain the decorator pattern, but if you go back to the previous episode in case you missed it, then you will see a detailed explanation with an implementation about this. So in case of the decorator, just to finish answering the question as I promised, in case of the decorator, we have an interface again, but in case of the decorator, both the decorated object and the decorator, they already implement the same interface. So it's mandatory for them to implement the same interface if we want to be able to decorate then the decorator, so that we create, as I said, an infinite number of layers, meaning theoretically an infinite number of layers, unlimited, maybe it's better to say. So then I have the client always exists, so that's the object using the decorator, using the pattern. So there is somewhere there is an object using that decorator, same as in this case there was an object using the adapter for some reason. In the previous episode I just had a main method using directly creating the object, but being that you theoretically, being that Java is object oriented and you use an object oriented way of designing the things, then you will have an object. And then we have the interface, and then again both the object you want to decorate and the decorator needs to implement the same interface. So this is first object is the one you decorate. I'm not sure if there is anything like decoratee. I don't want to abuse of my English, because I'm not a native speaker, so it's anyway my accent is not that good, but I don't want also to now invent words in the vocabulary, but that's the decorated object, so let's at least call it the decorated object. I will say here decorated. And then you have the decorator, basically, which decorator decorated. This is the decorated object, and the decorator is just near it. Both objects basically implement the same interface. And the decorator wraps over the decorated object. So I will draw an arrow then from the decorator to the decorated object. So from the decorator that again extends, it actually implements, it's an interface, so it implements the interface. and contains the decorated object, so it wraps over, same as the adapter wraps over the adaptee, the decorator here wraps over the decorated object. So that's basically the same thing. That's what, again, as I said in the previous episode, makes these two design patterns similar. In both cases, in the adapter and the decorator, you have an object wrapping over another, just that again the purpose is different. So instead of adapting from an interface to another, you can see clearly here that the adaptee was not implementing the interface, and the role of the adapter was to simply adapt that object to the interface, otherwise the client couldn't use it. In case of the decorator pattern, which is the one below, you can see that again we have that client using the interface. It could have used directly the decorated object, but instead it uses the decorator just because it wants to enhance the decorated object with specific functionality. And you might have multiple implementations of the decorator. So in my simplistic representation here, I only drew a rectangle representing the decorator, but if you go back to the previous episode, you will remember that we discussed and even implemented our own decorator with two or three, and you can have as many as you want implementations. So that's why in some books or articles you will basically see it represented this way. So instead of only having one decorator that's wrapping over the decorated object, as I presented here for my simplistic simplistic explanation to make it more straightforward for you, let's say, you can complete the diagram by making sure that you make it by making sure you add the fact that you can have multiple implementations. So that's why you can basically represent here the decorator as its own interface that is extending from the interface. That's still mandatory, so it's just an interface segregation here to make it easier to understand. And then instead of having only one decorator, you basically, which is the real world situation, you basically can have as many implementations as you want. So these two rectangles you see right here, they are implementations of the decorator, and each one of them then will wrap over the decorator. So we'll basically, you will need to have somehow an arrow of the fact that each adaptee contains the interface itself. And I think a little bit earlier I was a bit wrong, because I drew the arrow from the decorator to the decorated object, making this easier to understand. But in reality, the decorator has inside still the interface. Remember that from the previous episode, because we want to make that possible. The decorator can decorate itself, and any implementation, any decorator implementation, can decorate another decorator, which can decorate another decorator, and which at the end will decorate the object. And that's basically the diagram. And of course you need an arrow also from here to here, so the fact that any implementation of the decorator contains the interface, making it possible that the decorator not only decorates one object, but can only decorate another decorator. And hopefully with these diagrams I answered your question, and I also made previous episode easier to digest, and now you understand even better how the decorator and the adapter work. Let me know if you have questions, because I want to answer them. Now let's step a bit forward and discuss Singleton. For Singleton, I don't plan to show you a diagram, because it's basically a very simple design pattern that would only have a class and a client. I would, however, like to show you some implementation and discuss some things about Singleton that are less known. So this is the design patterns, I think is episode 5, hopefully I'm not mistaken, and then I will say example 1, or like this, underscore 1, and while my IntelliJ loads the project and I can start working on it, let's see what Singleton is. I would like to make you aware of the fact that in books, even in books and also around the web, I've seen that people used to shorten a bit the definition of the singleton, making that confusing, especially for beginners, about what singleton is. So if you search here and there, you will see that many people define the singleton as being the way of writing a class such that its create only creates one instance. So what does that basically mean? What is only creating one instance? This is actually half of the definition of what singleton is. It's true that in case of the singleton, the purpose is, one of the purposes is having one instance of that class. But the second and very important part of the definition is that any other object in the application should easily access that same instance. So it's not only that singleton implies you only have an instance of that object, it's also that any object of the program should effectively and easily access that instance. And I think that's even more important than from the definition of the singleton than the fact that you only have one instance. So it's very important to remember that singleton means you only have one instance, and the other half of the definition, which is often missing, and that instance needs to be easily accessed by any object of the application. And that makes the singleton implementation being implemented the way you see it in many places, and the way I will demonstrate it now. So how do we assure such an implementation of an object where the object can be accessed from anywhere in the application and to anyone accessing that object, always the same instance is delivered? Let me create some kind of a main package here first, and let's start with an example of an object and apply a first singleton implementation. Again, I was telling you earlier that to implement this design pattern, you have a lot of ways, you have a lot of options with the language to implement it, and I will basically start with the simplest and the first approach that usually everyone learns, and then I will complicate the things, and I will show you also, I will focus more on the most important, the one I consider the most important approach, because you want to find it the most often in real world apps, and it has some characteristics that we will discuss which makes it usable in I would say any situation. So say I want to make sure that I have this singleton class called singleton1, because I'm not really inspired now with names, and I want to make sure that from everywhere you create an instance of singleton in the app, you always get the same instance. So if I have a main class here and the main method, and that will be used by me to demonstrate the singleton. How can I make sure that when I call or I create an instance of singleton here, whether it was or not already created somewhere in the application, that will be for sure the same instance? So there is definitely not something I can do by using the constructor, isn't it? Because if I would say singleton1 as new singleton, then on the other hand, I'm actually pretty sure this will always be a new instance. So it's definitely not the way to make sure that I have the same instance throughout the whole app. The first thing I really need to make sure when I create a singleton to make sure that no one will be able to create another instance is to make sure no one can actually use this syntax, because you can see if I can use this syntax, then it means I can use a different, I can always create a different instance of the object, isn't it? So the first main, the main thing you start with when designing the singleton is making sure this is impossible. This usage of creating the instance of singleton needs to be impossible if you want to make sure that you have only one instance throughout the whole app. So the first thing we need to make sure to make it a singleton, the first thing we need to make sure is that this is impossible. Calling the constructor from outside to create a new instance should be impossible, otherwise it's not a singleton. So how can we do that? Well, basically, for everyone that knows the Java fundamentals, knows that inside the class, defining something as private makes it usable only inside that class. So that applies even to the constructor. So if I'm writing something like this, now I'm actually defining my own constructor. So the default one, as the language fundamentals say, won't exist anymore. And if I make it private, if I use the private access modifier, then I make sure that the constructor itself cannot be called from outside that class. So now I only have one constructor for the singleton class, and I'm pretty sure that no one outside of this class can call it. So if I'm going back to main, you will see that this became a compilation error, because of course something private cannot be anymore called from outside of the class. So I solved one of the problems. Now, what do I have to do to get an instance here? So to get an instance here, I need to implement somehow a way through the class itself to get that instance, because I'm now sure that creating an instance is something that only the class itself has the privilege to do. Why? Because I made the constructor private. So it's definitely clear now that only the class itself can create an instance. So if I want to get a singleton instance, the only way I can do that would be through the class. So what shall I do? Well, I shall create something that can be called from outside of the class without having an instance of the class. And that something should return me a singleton instance. So again, what is something I can call from outside of the class without needing an instance? It definitely needs to be a static block of code, because if it's not a static block of code, then you wouldn't be able to call it without having already an instance. But we know that we need to call that block of code to create an instance. So it's definitely not something that cannot be static. It needs to be static, because I need to be able to call it without having the instance. Otherwise, I'm in a deadlock. I need an instance to call that block of code to create an instance. It's not possible, isn't it? So that's why we always, in the singleton, have a static block of code that is called to create that instance. So it's a static method. Say static singleton one, usually called get instance. So we usually call this method get instance. It's not mandatory, of course, but it's basically some best practice just to call it get instance, because it makes sense. It's a method used to get an instance of that class, so it makes sense to call it get instance. It returns an instance of that class. It's public, so we can call it from anywhere. And the most important thing is static, because otherwise you wouldn't be it wouldn't be possible to call it without having an instance. So say var s1 is singleton get instance, and I can call the method from the class itself without having an instance, because it's static. If you don't have the Java fundamentals, Before following this stream of design patterns, of course, the recommended is first you learn the Java fundamentals. And for the Java fundamentals, I already have a full 70-something series of lessons on the same channel. So please do follow that before. It makes sense, otherwise you might not understand my explanations here and you might get confused. So I consider that you know the Java fundamentals now, and if you don't understand, if you don't know what static is, and if you don't understand my explanation here, it means you need to first go and study the Java fundamentals stream. And of course, anytime if you have questions, do ask me and I will try to answer in the most clear way possible. So that's why we have this method. Now, definitely we need here to return an instance, and you can't simply just return an instance this way, just creating it this way, because if you would do something like that, well, it will always be a different instance. But what we need is to make sure that we always have the same instance. So what we can do is declare a variable only accessible inside the class that stores a reference of that class itself. And what we do is we say first it will have the value null. So we start with an empty variable. So we start without having any instance of the class. Whenever someone calls the guest get instance, if this variable is null, it actually means that no one ever created an instance of this class. So what do we do if we don't yet have an instance? We create it. We create that instance and we store that instance, actually the reference of that instance, in that variable. So if anyone has already called the get instance, then the instance has been created, its reference has been saved in the singleton variable, and then the singleton variable is not null anymore. So we return the singleton variable, and now what happens is that the first time this method is called, this variable is null, so this condition is true, which means that the block of code of the if statement will be executed, a new instance will be created, and its reference will be stored, making it the only instance we have. At the same time, making the singleton variable different than null, because it now contains the reference of an object, and we just have to return that reference further. When the second, third, and so on call will be executed on the getInstance method, now this condition is false, because the first call already assigned the value in the singleton, so the singleton is not null anymore. So basically this statement here, this if statement that creates the instance, will only be executed, what's inside the curly braces will only be executed once, when first time the getInstance is called. The second, the third time, the nth time getInstance is called, will simply return that already created instance, that only instance that has been once created the first time getInstance has been called, and now anyone using it throughout the app, you can call this from anywhere as many times as you'd like, and every time, each and every time, you will basically get the same instance, because this is where, when I call it, and wherever it would be in the app, the first call creates the instance, and then any other call from wherever it comes, it will only get the already existing instance. So this is basically fulfilling what we wanted to get from the singleton itself, which by the definition, going back to the definition, the singleton was having one instance of that class, but also having the possibility to get it from anywhere in the application easily without caring of how the instance is created. So the clients of the getInstance method, the objects using this method, they don't have to care how the instance is created. They always need to make sure that whatever they get is the same instance that other objects from other places of the application got. And that's precisely what happens here. With one or more things to add, because this was only the simplest implementation, which, as I will continue telling you now, is not something you can use when you have multiple threads. Remember, the threads are basically independent set of instructions that can execute in parallel. Again, I will consider this part of the Java fundamentals, so in case you don't know what multi-thread applications are, go back to my Java fundamental stream and watch that part where I explain what multi-threaded apps are. What I will tell you now is that this implementation of Singleton is not something you can use when you have an application using multiple threads, or you can use it with multiple threads with the condition that you make sure always the getInstance method is called from the same thread, so it's not shared by multiple threads. Otherwise, this basically will not work, and I will now explain why. So let's say, can we do singleton in line 5 and just have return statement in the getInstance method? Yes, we can do that. Basically, very good question, Arnold. Thank you very much for the question. So I told you from the beginning, there are many ways to implement a singleton. I think I know at least 5 ways to implement with Java. I think I actually know more than 5 ways to implement the singleton with Java. So yes, you basically have the possibility of creating the singleton here and directly returning it. That's what we call the eager singleton implementation. The eager singleton implementation. Sorry. So that this is what implementation I've shown you here is usually the first one used to explain how singleton works, and it's called the lazy lazy instantiation of the singleton. That means the singleton instance will be only created when someone requests it. So if no one calls the getInstance method, then no singleton is created. So that's why it's called lazy, because the object itself is created only if it is mandatory required. While in case of adding here the singleton, will always be created that instance whenever first time the class is loaded by the Java virtual machine. So that means that you can use the class from for a different purpose than creating the instance, and then the singleton will be, however, created even though you don't use it. That's called the eager implementation, because it creates the instance instantaneously without even needing to request it, without even needing to use it. So you might have cases where you don't call the getInstance, but the instance will be created. So that's the difference between what you refer to is the eager implementation. What I implemented here is the lazy implementation. Both cases, both of them work similarly. Just that, again, as by my explanation, in this case, the instance will only be created if someone really calls the getInstance method. Now, why is this implementation not a good one when having a multi-threaded app and trying to use it from multiple threads? You will basically never see this implementation in a real-world app, mostly because real-world apps today assume that you have more threads. So It's very unlikely you will find this implementation in a real world app, and it's very likely that you will see this implementation only in examples and tutorials like this one, because it's the first one and the easiest one you can use to understand first what Singleton is from the design pattern point of view. But in case of a multi-threaded app, this simply doesn't work. And the reason it doesn't work is because if two threads simultaneously, two or more than two threads simultaneously call the getInstance method the first time, they might get into the situation where both of them reach the condition of the if block at the same time, which means that both of them, or again two or more threads, will see the singleton as being the singleton variable as being null. So they will all see the condition as being true, so they will all enter the if block, and instead of creating only one instance, they will create multiple instances of the class. And it's possible that only the last one will be returned. It's possible that more instances will be used depending on what happens there. I won't go into details because that's a multi-threaded stuff which we don't have to discuss now. What's important, what's relevant to remember is that it's clear that because we have no synchronization here, at least there is a chance that more threads will simultaneously go into this instruction and create more instances. And that's clearly against what Singleton requires. So this is clearly an implementation that is not a singleton in case you refer to using multiple threads. So what can we do about that? Let's take another implementation and see what can we do about it. So the second implementation I'm going to show you is the synchronized method singleton implementation, which is the simplest approach that you can make to make sure that this becomes a synchronized singleton and can be used from multiple threads. But the only reason I'm showing you this implementation is to tell you not to ever use it. So and that's basically using here the synchronized word. So if you do that, you solved the problem. You solved the problem, but in the worst way possible. You now can have multiple threads, and it's sure and it's pretty clear that being that you synchronize the full block of code of the getInstance method, definitely there is no possibility that multiple threads will run into this condition at the same time, which means that this became a singleton for multi-threaded apps as well. But there is a big but here, because again, I told you never use this, and you need an explanation. Why shouldn't you use this as long as it seems to be better than this one? Well, actually it's not, it's even worse. If I would choose between using this, if I know I have only one thread, for example, I would go with choosing this. But using this implementation, I would never recommend it with or without one thread. And the reason is, if you synchronize the method by using the synchronized keyword directly on the method signature, what the fundamentals tell us is that now you have basically synchronized all the calls to this method. What does that mean? Is that you have synchronized not only the first call, which was the relevant one, but you synchronized absolutely all the calls that will happen from now on in your application on this method. And why is that bad? Because it's definitely the least performant implementation you could have chosen for your singleton. If you go back to my explanation here, you will observe that the only problem you have with the singleton implementation is the first call of the getInstance, because that's anyway the only one where you could encounter a problem. So it's the only one where you could have this situation where multiple threads would go into the same instruction that creates the object. So otherwise, if one thread already goes that way, created the instance, returned the and returned the value, then the second thread, the third thread, the fourth thread, if they go those times simultaneously, it doesn't matter, because then the singleton condition is anyway false already, so they all of them will go here and get the already created instance. So basically, this implementation of singleton only has a problem with the first call. Only the first call should be synchronized. And that's basically where we will go now to the third implementation of singleton, to try answering the question, how can we only synchronize the first call and not all of the method calls? Where there is a possibility, and I will show you that possibility, which you will find potentially in real world apps. I will later then show you even a better approach, but I want to show you this one because it will open not only the idea of implementing a synchronized singleton, but you will also potentially find this useful later in similar situations. And that's a way of implementing a class called the two-step check synchronization. So what we will do is, instead of using the synchronized keyword on the full block of the method, I will add the synchronization here. Basically, I'm inside a static block of code. So what I can do is basically using the prototype of the class itself as the monitor of the block of code. And then what I will basically do is, I'm going to say, do only apply the synchronization when the singleton is null. And this two validation step of the synchronization basically solve my problem. For any beginner, this looks strange at the first time. Sorry, I need to move this a little bit down below. Okay, now it's correct. And for a lot of students, usually for beginners, this is confusing. It's confusing because they see the same condition twice. And doesn't this sound illogically? Why would you add the same condition twice? I mean, it looks like the condition, it does the same thing, isn't it? But actually, if you are attentive, you will see that the condition doesn't do the same thing. So the condition here is just to make sure that the singleton object will only be created if no thread has already created an object. So this is the same condition we previously used. While this condition over here is simply used to make sure that only the first time we go into the synchronized block, and then the second, third, fourth call of the getInstance method and so on will never get into the synchronization, because the condition will be false before the thread will go into the synchronized instruction. So whenever any thread will call the method second, third, fourth time, they will first reach this condition, which will be false, and then they will immediately return the singleton, which already has a value. For the first time, when multiple threads will at the same time go into the getInstance method, say we have a couple of threads entering at the same time here, it is possible that both of them will enter this condition. So both of them will enter here and will be blocked by the synchronized block, which will only allow one of them to step further into the block. because the that's the way synchronized works. So even if multiple threads would call the method at the same time, they potentially could all of them go over the condition, because for all of them the first time the condition will be true, but only one of them will be allowed to step into the creation of the singleton by the synchronized keyword here, by the synchronized block. So that's why only one of them will manage to enter here, actually create the singleton. And then when the others that were blocked by synchronized and that are waiting will get into, they will be kicked out by this condition, which you see is important to be there. Because if we only had this condition, then remember the first time all of them would have been possible to get into the synchronized. And then if multiple threads are here, you still need to make sure again, once again, that you clean out all the others. You still need this condition to make sure that if there were two threads here, one of them entered, created the singleton, the second one entering will be kicked out by this condition and will not reach anymore the creation of the singleton. So that's why this implementation is better than the previous one, because the previous one assumed that always the get instance will be synchronized, even when it doesn't make sense. And it doesn't make sense, for example, when for the second, the fourth, and so on calls, because then it anyway the singleton has already been created, so you don't need the synchronization anymore. This one makes sure that the synchronization is only applied the first time, which is basically what you want, which is basically what you need. But there are even better ways to write the singleton, and I will basically end today's episode with the one I recommend you use. Sorry for that, I'm not sure what I did. So the one that I recommend you use in real world apps. So in real world apps, I recommend to use the singleton created with a nested class. So what is that? Instead of having any condition, you just write it like this. You say private static final class singleton holder. And inside you have a private static final singleton for, in my case, singleton. And it simply creates the instance this way. And now what the only thing I need to do is just return singleton holder singleton. And this is basically a synchronized singleton, and this is the simplest way from my perspective to write a singleton with a class. Now you can implement singletons with enums. I could show you that. Honestly, I've never seen anyone using in practice something like that. So let's step over it, because it doesn't make sense to discuss all the possibilities. Let's make it only the relevant ones. And today with the later Java versions, we have record classes, and again you can use records to implement the singleton as well. Let's stick on those for the moment, which are the most relevant. This singleton for implementation is probably the one that you will most likely use in practice, and is the one I recommend. And of course I would like to explain you better why this is a singleton first, because it might be unclear if it's the first time you see this this way of writing the singleton. It might be unclear why is this actually a singleton first, and then why is that synchronized, because as you can see here there is no synchronized word anywhere. So where is the synchronization? How is this even concurrent without having the synchronization word anywhere in the class? So let's remember what nested classes are and how the Java virtual machine actually creates classes. So what happens behind the scenes in the JVM, as a short story, because I don't want to go now in the full class loader mechanism, because it doesn't make sense. But when the JVM creates an instance, first of all, it loads the class itself. That's why we can even use that syntax, singleton name of the class, name of the class dot class, to refer to the blueprint, the blueprint, the object representing the blueprint. So this mechanism, which is behind the scenes in the JVM, creates the instance that in earlier versions of Java it was stored in the perm generation, now it's stored in the metaspace. The idea is that the class loader itself is synchronized. So it's synchronized because, of course, when it loads a class, the class loader itself doesn't want to load that class twice. So you can make sure that the JVM itself has the implementation of the class loader made in such a way in which it only loads a class one time. And if the class that applies, whether the class is an outer one like this one, a top level class, or it's a nested one like this one. So what happens here is that when I will call the getInstance method, basically, because I refer to the singleton holder, the class loader will load the singleton holder in a synchronized way, making sure that it loads the singleton holder only once. So that makes, first of all, executing by Java specification, again, I'm going back referring to the fundamentals, executing all the static blocks of code, which includes this one. So when the class loader will load the singleton holder, we'll automatically create this instance and store it here. And I'm very sure that that will happen only once, because itself, the loading of the class inside the JVM in the class loader mechanism is implemented synchronized. So first of all, it's a singleton, because the class loader only loads once the any class, be it nested or not. So I'm pretty sure that this block of code will only execute once, because that's by Java specifications. And I'm pretty sure this happens synchronized, and is the same thing that will happen even if called from multiple threads, because again, is the class loader inside that makes sure this will happen only once. And because is inside the JVM natively implemented, is the fastest synchronization. Basically, it's a faster synchronization than using the synchronized word, as I did here in case of the Singleton 3 demonstration. So that's basically it. I don't have a lot of time left, but I still have things to say about Singleton. And the things I still want to say about Singleton are, first of all, what happens if you have multiple class loaders, because that's something that a lot of people don't take into consideration. For example, is this or this or this or this actually a singleton in any case of any Java application? And the truth is that there is still a little start there where you can consider any of these not being singletons. And that's when you have multiple class loaders. And what happens with frameworks such as Spring or any enterprise edition or Jakarta implementation? We do find the word synchronized, the term synchronized, being used there a lot. Is that the same thing as what I explained here? I want to answer all these questions in the next episode, telling you what happens when you have multiple class loaders, and telling you what happens in Spring or other frameworks such as Jakarta implementations. I'd like to take what singleton means in those and make the difference, so that you are aware of, when you hear the word singleton, what's different between singleton pattern versus the Spring singleton versus a Java EE singleton. And the last question, I think, so the difference between this and the earlier Eager implementation is that there is a singleton is instantiated only when getInstance is called. So this one here, no, basically, so let's actually implement also, because I want to make sure I'm clear. Let's implement the lazy one, okay? The eager one. So the eager one would look like this. It actually look like this. Singleton 5. Singleton 5. And here I only return singleton. And singleton is this one, but it's instantiated there. Okay, so the difference between 5 and 2, because we can only compare these two, so singleton 5. So the difference between what's that, singleton 5, sorry, copy paste, I shouldn't do that, singleton 5. So the difference between 5 and 1 is that here is, being a eager implementation, basically you can refer to singleton 5, the class, without even calling getInstance, and then this instance will be created. However, again, this is not something you can use on multiple threads. In this case, in this case, can you use it on multiple threads? I think you basically can, do you? Because when you load this one, you create this one. Yeah, that's a good point. But the problem is that you get into the case where you... I'm not sure. I have to go look a bit more into that. Because if you call the get instance here... So I'm actually confused. I think it's too late for me here and I'm confused. But I will come back to you, but I'm potentially telling you now this is not synchronized. That's because you call the get instance, which has been already created here. It might be so. Sorry, I will come back to you with that because I'm confused now. But the idea is that that can be, isn't it? But in this case, basically, you will have the singleton only when the singleton holder is instantiated. So that means you will get the singleton back when you call the get instance, because only then you refer to a singleton holder, and then you, in that case, get the singleton instance back. Okay, cool. I will come back to this one because I'm a bit confused now, because I'm, if you are instantiating it like this, then it's clear that you will just refer to the class and you don't even need to refer to this method. But then I think this will also be, in this case, synchronized, because it's still the class loader who will create this one. But the problem is, in this case, that you will create the instance even though you might not need it in any case. So that's, I think, the only difference it is with the other one. While in the previous one, you have only have the instance when referring to the singleton holder, which is only when you call the get instance method, actually. Yeah, so you managed to make me confused, but yeah, I'm sometimes getting confused myself. Because as I always say, I don't know them all, so even singleton can be complex, as I started with from the beginning. So the time is up. Thank you very much for watching this episode again, and thank you very much for all your appreciations. I promise I will write more books too, and I will try to make that knowledge, share that knowledge of understanding a large code base as well. But up to that point, thank you again and have an excellent time for learning further. Cheers, and see you in the next episode.